Well, come on in. Please take a seat, and we'll get started. We're trying to get our audio in set. Are we all set? Okay, follow. So a little bit about my profession. About 100 years ago, 110 years ago, this city had a population of roughly 500 people. And it was a farming village. But on the East Coast and across the pond in London, they were facing incredible problems in their cities. The cities were not very desirable places. They had a lot of pollution. There were concerns related with light and air. In some cases, they had incompatible uses next to each other. They would have laundromats, or they would have industrial plants right next to single-family residences where people lived. That was a health crisis of the day, 100 years ago. And that gave rise to the planning profession as we know it. And in 1920s and 30s, cities all over the country adopted zoning ordinances to address this health concern. One of the things is we can't have industrial plants right next to single-family residences where people live. Oh, by golly, we can't have single-family right next to apartments. We need to separate them out. And we started separating these uses out. And the further and further they got, the more difficult it became to walk within these places. Here we are 100 years later, facing yet another health crisis. I became aware of this health crisis listening to Dr. Jackson, listening to his mini-series that was aired on PBS that talked about the relationship between public health and our cities, our built environments. And I was struck by a statement that he made that I heard him, and I'm paraphrasing now, that the way we are designing and planning our cities today may be killing us. And that was a paradigm shift for me as I reflect back on the primary purpose for my profession, which is health, safety, and welfare, and coming full circle 100 years later back on health, safety, and welfare. So it's my utmost joy to welcome Dr. Jackson. Dr. Jackson is a pediatrician. He has held a top position at the CDC, leadership position at the CDC. He's written a number of books. He's brought some of them with him. And he has hosted a three-part series on PBS on designing healthy communities. And is a most sought-after speaker. On any given day, he is traveling somewhere giving this exact talk, that, or perhaps a different one, that we are about to get today. So it's a real treat to have him amongst us. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Richard Jackson.
Thank you, Kaiser. Oh, good. It's Aunt Mike. I grew up in New Jersey. I have to tell the young people this. And I never learned when I was young that if I had to raise my voice to get to the back of the room, I had to do it without sounding angry. So now I've perfected how to speak loudly without sounding angry, because if you're from Newark, New Jersey, that's the way you communicate. But I moved to California for medical school in the late 60s, and much to my mother's dismay, she said, you know, you're going to marry some beautiful California blonde and not come back. And she was right. So here I am. And I'll talk a little bit more about it, but maybe, and I don't want to make this too long, but I'm going to ask people, just say your name and maybe one sentence about your interest in this issue, or whether you think it's nonsense or anything else. I don't mean to put people on the spot. If you don't want to do it, you don't have to, but I'm going to just go around. I want to get to know you a little bit. And
Harry, lifespan.
So all age groups and everything else, and what do we do to in a community to make it work?
Sally, we ignore health in all of our planning.
Sally, I went to medical school for 4 years, and I never heard the word health once. I learned 1,200 different diseases, but I never learned anything about health that whole time. I had to get out and become a real pediatrician? Actually, I learned a lot of it from my mother and my grandmother, because that's where most of us learn it.
My name's Kelly, and I'm a recovering city planner.
And you look like such a nice person, Kelly, I must say. Well, I'm... Well, actually, I'm a member of the American Public Health Association. It was founded about 130 years ago. Seven of the members of the founders of the American Public Health Association were urban planners. Two of them were physicians. So planning, the idea that planning and health were linked together was deep in their DNA. It's exactly what Kaiser was reflecting. Please, a quick intro.
My name is Bianca, and I associate happiness with health.
Bianca, when I get so annoyed when I listen to politicals and they say we're spending 18% of all of our money on health care, and I scream at the TV, no, we don't spend it on health care. We spend it on medical care. We spend about 1-2% on health. And I'll talk about what I'll just say it right now. The two things that improved health most between 1900, the days we were talking about, and today, what do you think the two things are, and they both start with the letter I? One was immunization, and it added enormous amounts to the lifespan, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as I go forward. And the other is infrastructure. Clean air, clean water, clean food, safer workplaces, safer roadways. It was the changes in the physical environment and our immunity that really added, get this, 25 of the 30 years of additional lifespan came from those two big eyes. So I'm over at UCLA. I teach somewhat in pediatrics and urban planning and law and public policy. And I'm sure if I went across the street, they have all these banners, best in the West, all over UCLA. And if I said to one of the doctors there, oh, you know, people live 30 years longer than they did a century ago, he'd say, yeah, we're really good doctors. Yeah. And they've done 1,000 transplants, heart-lung transplants, really difficult medical stuff. But a lot of these don't add that much to the average lifespan of a whole population. It's really the two big eyes that have added the most. Quick intro, please.
My name is Delaine, and I'm interested as an environmental planner with the planning process and healthy design living.
Great to meet you. One of my friends is Delaine Easton, who was the superintendent of education. And I'm going to just riff on that for 1 second. I would go to, when I was at CDC, and I was there for 10 years as the head of environmental health for the United States of America. And every week I'd have to go somewhere. And I remember having to go to the Capitol and get my fair share of abuse, as the Rolling Stones would say. And I remember walking along, and here's Health and Human Services, the Humphrey Building. Well, that's a health agency, of course. Next one down is Department of Education. Education is one of the, if you want to figure out how long somebody's going, how much longer someone has to live, what's the most important thing? Now, you're all wrong, it's age. Yeah, that's the big risk factor for dying is age. But yeah, I know it's so obvious we wouldn't think of it. The second biggest risk factor, though, is education. And the more people can be educated, the longer we live, the healthier we are. The third, and I see young people here, third is race and your zip code and where you live. Your zip code accounts for your lifespan in America more than your genetic code. And so what you build is really, really important. So Delaine had really, Easton, when she was the Secretary of Education, I was Governor Schwarzenegger's health officer for California for about a year and a half. And when I arrived, he said, what are your priorities? And I told him bioterrorism, because I had just come from CDC and September 11th and all that stuff. And number three was hospital infections. And I said, number two was the obesity epidemic. And I could just imagine Governor Schwarzenegger, who probably was a puny kid in Bavaria, thinking, well, obesity is a personal decision. I said, no, it isn't. We have a culture and an environment that drives people towards ill health. And a certain amount of our overweight, yes, is our own failure to control our appetite. But the whole advertising structure, the food availability, the costs are all driving us towards ill health from what we eat. So we're really being controlled by environment in a bigger sense than just, you know, the trees and the chairs and all the rest. So please, intro.
I'm Carol Gallegos. I'm the manager of our local farmers market, so I'm very interested in that.
I don't need to preach to you, Carol. I mean, yeah. One of the things I said to the governor and was, Governor, I want a farmers market in every town in California. And, well, you know, to be honest, the more educated, well-off towns do pretty well, but a lot of really poor communities are the ones that are desperate for it and don't have it. And so I worked very hard, and I'm proud of this. We got food stamps or SNAP being usable now. And do you have the 2-for-1? Yes, because...
I don't have the market match here yet because the grant was too late to get this year. We're going to try and apply next time. I have two farmers markets. My other farmers market, I do. But we do have EBT and WIC, the WIC and the EBT.
You know, God bless you, because this is really important to people's health. And one of the problems for poor folks is they go to the farmers market and the prices are kind of set for upper middle class folks. And they get there and they can't afford it. There are two good things that have happened. One is if you wait till about noon, the prices drop, right? Because the really pretty stuff, you know, the perfect-looking stuff gets sold. And it's just as nutritious at noon. The second thing is with the change in the food stamps, people could get, you know, a food stamp dollar or whatever it would be called is worth $2, and you could buy a whole lot more. And it's nonsense to be eating stuff from Chile that's flown 5,000 miles when we can be growing stuff down the road. So help. The next thing along the road, walking along in Washington, D.C., was the Department of Transportation. Is transportation a health issue? You bet it is. You bet it is, and I hope the students will speak to me about that. The next one further down is the Department of Energy. Rick Perry, who didn't know it existed, is now the head of it. And is that a health issue, energy? Why? Where do you think most of our pollution's coming from is how we burn fuel and it degrades our air quality and a lot of other things. The next one down, just to be complete, is the Department of Agriculture. Is the Department of Agriculture a health agency? Yes. Oh, you bet. They spend $40 billion, I think, on price supports and food stamps and nutrition, right? So they have a huge impact on what people eat, particularly poor people.
Hello, my name is Conan, and I'm a public health professional, environmental health, and I work for a large infrastructure development company. So,
good to be with you. I'm going to nag the environmental health people because they need to stop thinking about rats, restaurants, and radiation and think more about the big context of where we are living, because it's this really trajectory of where we're going as a society. So,
hi there, Dr. Marina. I'm on the city council here. Former mayor, I heard you speak a couple years ago and share your interest in active living, green space, and bringing, you know, sort of all that combined to the urban setting for all communities.
Did I meet you with Michael Beck down in the basement there that time?
That's right, you did.
Now he's our provost.
Yeah, he went to UCLA, yeah.
We're glad to have him. He's a good guy.
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm also a planning commissioner, so I'm looking to get to know a little bit more about health policy. Affordable housing?
Well, wait a minute. The housing agency is the next one down. Are they a health agency?
My name is Eileen, and I'm a former teacher. I'm raising four boys here in South Pasadena, and I grew up in Pasadena when we had smog days for where we had to have indoor recess because of smog days. So I'm glad to see that my boys aren't experiencing that, and I'm interested in city planning and being active in our community.
You know, I didn't put the air pollution slides in, but remind me, because some of them are just stunning, the improvement in lung functions in young people because of the improvements. And people thought we did it to, you know, save our catalytic converters or to have airplanes land safely at LAX. Do you know that the military were afraid sometimes to land at LAX and military jets because the smog was so bad they couldn't see the runway? This is the 1950s. And I think this is a joke, but people have told me that there were kids that grew up in parts of South LA that didn't know there were mountains because of the smog, which is really... Our middle son is a teacher, and God bless you. It's a really hard and important job.
Hi, my name is Julio Ortiz, and I'm a student at Cal State LA, environmental justice. So, yeah.
So we're going to talk about EJ, environmental justice, a bit more, because a couple of the big issues are gentrification versus displacement. So I hope we can get into this discussion, because A lot of real estate people think gentrification is a good thing. Well, the values go up, everybody wants to live there. I actually think fixing up the neighborhood, better policing, better parks, better cleaning, et cetera, is a good thing. But I think making it so poor people don't have a place to live, or at least, and by the way, workforce housing is just as important. Do you know that Santa Barbara has workforce? They just put her in around the hospital, their workforce housing. You know who they put in it? The doctors. They couldn't afford to live near the hospital in Santa Barbara.
My name is Joanna Huerta, and I also attend Cal State LA, and I'm currently in an environmental justice class.
My name is Yeleni Vega, and I also, too, I'm currently in environmental justice.
Hi, my name is Jafet, and I'm interested in, I'm also from Cal State LA, but I'm interested in like self-sustainability, local urban gardens, and affordable housing, too.
So I don't know if I'll get to this, but I really want to put this thesis before you. 8 years ago, 10 years ago, in architecture, the architects suddenly got religion, and that anything you build needs to be sustainable. And by that, it means to have as little carbon footprint as you can, use as much of the existing infrastructure as you can, capture the rainwater, put solar on the roof, be as energy efficient as possible. But you know what I've discovered in the last couple of years? Good sustainability and good health are like the railroad track receding in the distance, and they become one over time if you're really smart. Because if you make good sustainability, you can improve health, particularly for our grandchildren, your children, but also that, and there's been bad sustainable projects. I won't get into that. So how do you do it in the right way?
Liz, and I raised four children who came through the South Pass schools. My concern is not the kids, they ran around the city, but as I get older, it's harder for me to move around the city walking because of the big streets and the long time crossing. And I live on the south side of Huntington, and I'd love to be able to walk over or get simple transportation to the farmer's market and to Mission, but I can't because if I take a bus and I'm going to get the Gold Line, I have to go to Pasadena by the hospital to get another bus to get over to the Gold Line. So I just think that maybe cute little trolleys or something fun or better transportation for old folks as what we think about the young ones and the people that like to ride their bikes. But, you know, I sometimes even need a cane, and I'd like to be able to move around.
There's one minority you can join if you're lucky, which is the elderly. There's another minority you could join in a blink of the eye. What's that one? People with disabilities, in the blink of an eye. As a pediatrician, as worried as I was about hepatitis and meningitis, what worried me as a dad of three kids was particularly car trauma, car accidents, because a child can go from brilliantly healthy to terribly disabled in a blink of an eye. And so trauma is really far and away the number one that I worry about. And the issues that children, in general, I'm going to argue a little bit, I think the things that children need tend to be oftentimes the things that elderly need, that people who are disabled. One-third of the people in the United States do not drive. And so we build America for two-thirds of our population, we forget one-third of our population as we construct it, and it's In a way, it's as unjust as, talk about environmental justice. You're really in a very difficult pickle in large parts of Los Angeles if you can't drive. And you all know the story about immigrant moms and dads biking down the Venice, or many of the boulevards at night, at 6 o'clock in the morning going to work in the wintertime because it's still dark, and how dangerous that is for people, and they can't afford a car. And so it is really a justice issue that's very deep.
I'm Denny, and I'm a longtime resident of South Pasadena. And I would add a caveat to your point about the railroad tracks merging. It's good business, too, in the long run.
And Denny works for a bank, and she climbed a 75-story staircase, and I'm really impressed. So did I get it right this time? Thank you. Please.
My name is Adrian, and I also go to Cal State LA.
Hi, my name is Sal. I also attend Cal State LA with my fellow classmates, and I'm also part of the environmental justice class.
So I think I have one or two more people, and then you came to hear me talk, but I've actually given half the talk in the process of responding to your comments, so that's okay. I'm still learning. Good evening.
Hello, I'm Barbara. I'm really interested in this whole thing because I would like my city to be supportive of health, safety, attractiveness, ease of getting around, and something that might pay off for all the people who live here.
What's not to like about prosperity, right? Yeah. No, I thank you. You know, walking down the other side of the mall in Washington, D.C., you have the Federal Reserve, and so, you know, money is health, too.
I'm Ron. I'm a retired attorney, and I'm interested in everything about the city, so that's why I'm here.
Thank you, Ron. Did I get you already? Okay. Sorry. By the way, the secret of this is not to give up the microphone, because if you do, it'll go on for too long.
My name is Eric, and I am a former Cal State LA student, and I'm here to see if we could learn more about the 710 extension and effects it might have on South Pasadena.
Wow. You think that's important? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Merlin, and I'm as well with my classmates taking the environmental justice class, and I'm interested in health issues concerning with urban settings.
Any particular interests in young women? No, I mean in terms of these issues, because I'll come back to this. In my video series, I interviewed 5 to 6 young women living in Smyrna, Georgia, which is outside Atlanta, and they were about 15, 16 years old. And in the interview, they're living in sprawlburbia, suburban areas. And the interviewer said, well, what's it like to live here? They all look around. Finally, one says, boring. Well, what do you do for fun? Well, we go to the mall. Well, when do you go to the mall? Well, we have to ask our mother, so we only get to go to the mall about once. One of the mothers will take them about every 5 days. And I'm thinking back at age 15, I was never bored. And growing up in Pasadena, I suspect you were never bored. There was always something to do. And when I was young, I'm not making this up, about 70 to 80% of young people walked or biked to school. And today, it's about 13%. And there are lots of reasons for this, and I'll talk a little bit about the obesity epidemic, but more important in some ways than the obesity epidemic is the lack of fitness epidemic that we're seeing as well. And at this point, because of those two issues, listen to this. 2 out of every 7 volunteers for the U.S. military cannot get in because of lack of fitness and obesity. And that's tremendous. I recently heard, this may not be true, but my wife is telling me she heard a story about how they're having trouble with getting the young recruits to stand with an erect posture at attention because they have now spent the last 10 years hunched over like this. I don't know if that's true, but it is actually biologically plausible that they've reset their spines by doing this. So, this is the book I use when I teach at UCLA, and I'm now giving you 30 hours of lecture in 1 hour, so you have to pay attention. And I'm not selling any of them, but I do need them back because I need them as props. But in my class, I have about half public health students and about half students from other areas such as urban planning. And I compel them to do joint presentations. And it's back to that whole thing about public health. If we keep staying in our own stovepipe and don't reach out to all these other disciplines, we're going to be completely ineffective if we just deal with and talk to each other. So the joint presentations end up, the students teach each other an enormous amount. So maybe in class this would be worth doing. So you all know what a TOD is in this town, but you just don't quite know the abbreviation, a transit-oriented development. And with Measure M in Los Angeles and $30 billion going into transit and other kinds of things, they're going to have to put in a lot of transit nodes, basically subway stations with what are you going to have around it? You're going to have retail, you're going to have density. I would argue that that's exactly where you ought to put retail and density. And a lot of people in LA just want lots of parking because they live further out and they would like, they have a nice car and they want to take the nice car to the parking lot and get on the nice subway and go downtown. But in truth, a lot of poor people and people without cars think, hey, I'm the one that ought to be living there. And there are ways smart planners can figure out how to meet both needs and that we ought to be doing this. We have, by the way, we're overparked. We're actually two things. We're over-retailed in the United States. You all know how JCPenney and Sears and the rest of them are dying, partly because of Amazon, but partly because people have all the crap they can possibly need. They don't want to go shopping anymore. That's a scientific term, by the way. But the other is every car in America, we have more cars in California than we have licensed drivers. Every car in America needs about four parking spaces, one at work, one at home, one maybe a church or somewhere else, and one for the in the shopping mall for the Saturday before Christmas. And we just don't need as much parking. And one of my former colleagues, Don Shoup, has written whole books about parking. Anyway, so the young woman from public health decides she's going to do her presentation. She was working on violence against women. And she did not realize as a public health student that one of the best things you can do to prevent violence, for example, against women, is to have eyes on the street. And if the building has windows that you're walking down and there are people in there, the likelihood of something bad happening is far, far less. And I'm not making this up, but studies in Tampa, for example, where they had really pretty dangerous streets with crime and the rest, by just putting eyes on the street, and particularly, any of you have been on Bourbon Street in New Orleans, they have the balconies on the second floor. Well, the second floor balconies actually do a lot to reduce bad actors because the perps can't tell that somebody's looking down on them as they're walking along. So eyes on the street really matter. So she was beginning to learn this. She didn't realize something else, and this is important. And the students don't know this either. Everything you're looking at was in someone's imagination at some point in the past. This is why what you're imagining now with the planning is so important, because nothing will happen unless it's in your imagination. You know, it looks simple, this chair you're sitting in, but it probably took 100 hours of deep thought to design that simple object. And think about, and so the human imagination, how you want to shape your world, is profoundly important. So if you want to shape your streets in a way that a young woman could walk downstairs and the stairs would be daylit, I'm sure there were no windows in that stairway. You went all the way up, and it wouldn't have been anywhere near as bad a run if you had gone 75 flights with windows looking out at the city. But and you probably would have improved your vitamin D level, too. And but the young man was working, he was a planning student, and he was working on TODs, these transit-oriented developments. So they join up, and he had done all his drawings for his capstone, and they join up to do the presentation, and they get up and they do this spectacular presentation of, here's a TOD with eyes on the street, and all the hallways are designed, good sight lines, people feel comfortable, and they got along, and they got married. Now, the point of that story is, yeah, they got married, but the real point is that public health and planning were married 150, 120 years ago, because people knew what you built really influenced people's health. So that's the whole theme of the book that I'm passing around. But we go into deep detail about water and air and food and on and on and on. This book is the companion book for the PBS series, which has been shown in about 4 million homes in the United States. And it was a wonderful gift to me because I got to visit about 15 cities, including I had two camera crews in Detroit for 3 days and two in Atlanta for 3 days. And I learned a lot about what a lousy actor I am, but I got better at voiceover and that sort of thing. Governor Brown actually watched it. So for the students, a few years ago, this ad appeared in our college newspaper called the Daily Bruin. And it was clear that some advertising firm had done focus groups. Do you know what a focus group is? It's where we get six of you students and you sit at a table and a facilitator is asking you, what's your life like? Oh, you know, I'm up to my ears in debt and my parents don't understand me and my older brother's been out of work for 3 years and there's no jobs and somebody's behind a mirror and they're recording all of this. And one of the secrets of advertising is to figure out what it is that makes people nervous, what's resonating with the inside their soul. And they'll go after that thing and they'll really hit the button. So General Motors decided that what students really thought was, oops, sorry, that reality sucks. And so the campaign was, reality sucks, but it doesn't have to. You can go out and buy a GMC Sierra, and you can stop pedaling and start driving, and you can spend the next 7 years paying it off. And if you do, pretty girls will no longer smirk at you when you're saving gas, preventing congestion, getting physical exercise. And so I showed this in class that afternoon, and the students went crazy, the UCLA students. And they started tweeting all their friends, who tweeted all their friends. And like 10,000 people sent notes to GM by that night saying, that's a disgusting ad. That kid's doing exactly what he ought to be doing. And you shouldn't be telling people to stop pedaling and start driving. So I think the cultural shift in bicycle advocacy and activism really is important. But there's something else that exercise does. Which of you knows what the second most common disease in America is? Close. That's the second, that's the biggest killer, actually. Second most common disease is actually dental caries. It's cavities in your teeth. The second most common disease is depression. And your grandparents knew how to deal with depression. If they were living, you know, closer to a farm in a rural area, everybody gets depressed, the weather's lousy, you lose a loved one. And the way they dealt with it was festivals and I saw, as you were profiling what's going on, one of the most important things a community can do is, the built environment's very important, but you gotta activate those places. And we set aside 1% for public art. We ought to send 1% for festivals and events that get people out of their homes and get them to engage with people. Because what's the best treatment for depression?
Vitamin D.
Good, vitamin D. Yeah, but SSRIs, the Zoloft and the rest, are fine, but they're not as good as physical exercise, dancing, being out in the sunlight. We had that awful shooting at UCLA, and the cops were all over the place last May. And that night, the Latino students pulled together a folkloric dance festival with music and the rest. And it wasn't meant to be disrespectful. It was meant because when you're faced with life's overwhelming sadness, you need to embrace life even more than you would normally. And music and being with each other is a way to do it, and food as well. Some of you are interested in health, and these will be relatively quick, but this is the graph, and you're a nurse by training. This is the graph of when a child comes into the pediatrician, we map out their height, and then we want their weight to be roughly the same percentile. You know, if you're 70th percentile for height, we want you about 70th for weight, not 100th or not 30th. We're seeing kids like this, about four of them a day. Maybe not in your community, but around the country. And my son is an internist, and he's saying he's seen the same thing in adults. 50th percentile for height, 95th percentile for weight. If you're that much overweight, your blood pressure's too high, your cholesterol's too high, your blood sugar is too high, might have depression. A good doc doesn't immediately put somebody on drugs or do something like that. You know, get control over your life. No soft drinks in the house. God help me, South Pasadena. You need to vote a penny of sales tax on sugar-sweetened beveages. It raises now about $250,000 in Berkeley. It's being used for school physical activity, school gardens, teaching teachers about food and the rest. And it's reduced the amount of soft drinks that people are consuming. I believe that Coke and Pepsi the beverage industry spent something like 70 times as many dollars opposing this as the people that support it. Nevertheless, passed, and it's really accomplished good stuff. So get the soft drinks out of the house. If you can do it, no TV in the bedroom, no screen in the bedroom, because it disturbs sleep, and sleep is really important to health and to your weight and a lot of other things. Child comes back 2 months later, and what's changed? Nothing. Can't change the food at school, can't walk to school. My kids went to a school in high school, middle school and high school in Atlanta when I was at CDC for 10 years. There was not a sidewalk within 7 blocks of the school where they were at. There was no way they could walk, and I didn't want them to, particularly when the days were dark. So 2 months after that, the child's taking something for blood pressure, cholesterol, blood sugar, and the rest. And the point here is, and I've made this up, but it typically could be $300 a month in medical care. And the big message I want to say here is we have medicalized what is in fact an environmental threat, an environmental impact in these communities, which is why you as planning commissioners and people thinking about planning have huge impacts on health. Not tomorrow, but over the next generation. Because it took us 3 generations to build this, it's going to take a while to turn it around. We've rigged the environment against the child, we've rigged it against the doctor, and we've rigged it against the United States of America. And I'm not just making that up. Because we are now spending, it's no longer $8,500 per person in the United States on medical care, we're now spending $10,000 a year per person in the United States for medical care. And that's a huge amount of money, about 17% of the GDP of the United States. This is a map that simply shows, or a graph that shows, the longer, the more a country spends on medical care, the longer people live, except I made a mistake. You can't see it clearly, but there's a country left out. And the country I left out has that average lifespan of about 78 and spends the $10,000. So we are such an outlier compared to the rest of the world of how little we get for all the medical care dollars that we spend. And it's in part because we've underinvested in prevention. It's in part because we spent an awful lot of money at the end of life and sort of crazy decisions at that end. By the way, I think today is national, what's it called, final on our wills, where we say, I don't want my son, the doc, I said, look, living will, if I'm demented and I get pneumonia, please don't treat me. And, you know, final directives, yeah. And I've told you about 5 years were attributed to medical care. So the purpose of public health, and it's what I do, is to help create the conditions where people can be healthy. Sitting in a car is not good for you. I'm not making this up. It raises your blood pressure, your cholesterol, your blood sugar, your adrenaline levels, and your risk of having a heart attack. It's slight, but it stays up and then drops off for the hour or so after you get out of the car. So medically, it's not especially good for you. And being out, the other thing around cars is everybody my age in this room has lost a friend or a loved one to a car crash. And the risk of death for an American from car crashes is about 1 in 100 lifetime risk. So it's really quite high. Leading cause of death from ages 3 to 34 is car crashes. It's and as you said, it's the one thing we worry about more than else. Last year was the deadliest year on record in the United States. We've had 40,000 deaths. It was going down, 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 but in part people are driving faster and probably texting a lot more than they were in the past. So much more distracted driving than in the past, but it's really gone up quite a bit. Every time you drive 80 miles, you have bought a one in a million lottery ticket to die. So people say, oh, I don't want to live in an urban space, but people living in urban spaces are less likely to die in a pool of blood than the long-distance commuter who thinks I'm living out in the suburbs and it's safer. Urban spaces are actually, when you actually look at the real risks, the urban space is safer than the long-distance commute. And it's really expensive, $500 billion for just car crashes and costs. Our whole GDP is only $17 trillion. So it's $1.34 is going into the cost of car crashes. So apropos of older folks, and a lot of cities have done this, and I hope you would consider this. I've seen that it looks like you've made a lot of your streets two-way, which is really an important step in the right direction. I was in Boise, Idaho, and Colorado Springs, and they've still got a bunch of one-way streets. One-way streets is people drive very, very fast. Two-way streets just slow down, and if you actually put, and you've done a very good job putting in trees and other objects along the way, that slows drivers down too, because the perception of speed is much more if you have things around you objects that are moving than if you're moving on four lanes in one direction. People really speed in that situation. If you're hit by a car going 20 miles an hour, you have a 5% chance of dying. If you're hit by a car going 30, you have a 40% chance of dying. And if it's going, I'm sorry, I said 30, it's a 40% chance of dying. If it's going 40 miles an hour, you have an 80% plus percent chance of dying. So we have just instituted on the UCLA campus speed limits of 25 miles an hour, and we're in the process of ratcheting it down to 20. And the sign's going to say 20 is plenty. I'm in an argument with the provost about giving our police radar guns because it's very hard to enforce that kind of speed limit. But there's no reason somebody ought to be driving over a 250-acre campus at faster than 20 miles an hour. I won't dwell on this. How many of you have seen the obesity maps in the United States, please? Just put your hand up quickly. So it looks like about four or five people. So it isn't hugely boring for you, so I will take you through it. Here's obesity in 1990 in the United States. In California, and it doesn't matter how you define it, it's a body mass index of over 30. In California in 1990, less than 10% of Californians were obese. What do you think 1995 looked like? 10 to 15% of Californians obese. 2000, 15 to 20% of Californians obese. 2016, 20 to 25%. Alabama has over 35% of the people have body mass indexes over 30. The classic definition of obesity. Now, the point here is that we have changed our diet. We've made stuff that's bad for us, sugar, fat, and salt, really cheap. And human beings like sugar, fat, and salt. I love potato chips. I'm not proud of it, but I do. We like this kind of stuff. I think a real issue in the South and some of these places is, and people will say to me, you know, our comfort food in those hot parts of Alabama was, you know, chitlins and other such things. Yeah, lots of, but the truth was, if you're working outside doing hard manual labor, you might need 7,000 calories a day, and fat's the best way to get calories, and you might need a lot of salt because you're sweating all day. But if you're sitting at a keyboard, that's not the food that should be consumed. There are a lot of reasons for this. I'm not making this up. 56%. Sorry. The average shelf disappearance of high fructose corn sugar in the United States in the year 2000 was 56 pounds per person. Do you know what it was in the year 1978? Zero. We weren't putting high fructose corn sugar into everything. So we've changed the diet. So people are interested in agriculture. We've spent $13 billion a year on price supports for corn, soy, and the things that we shouldn't be eating so much of, and no price supports for things that California grows a lot of, like the row crops and rutabagas and artichokes. Things that really we ought to be eating more of in fruits and vegetables. Except we won't be able to harvest them because our president's not going to let any of the people to do the work in. But I'm going to skip this. As my body mass index goes up, I'm on the black line, my risk of developing diabetes goes up. So I apologize, you can't see it, but it's in essence that my BMI, my body mass, I'm about four times more likely to develop diabetes. If I were a woman, I'd have 16 times the risk. If I was very obese, I'd have close to 40 times the risk, and a woman would have about 100 times the risk. Well, so what? Diabetes, you know, we have drugs for that. Well, not really. What do you think happened to the diabetes maps in 1995? We're at 4 to 7% of the Californians diabetic in 1995, 2003. It looks like about 8%. 2016, we're at about 10% of our state in Alabama and Mississippi. They're close to 15%. So one person in six walking down the street has a disease that's going to cost them their eyes, their kidneys, and their feet, and their hearts. This is really, diabetes is very expensive. It adds about $15,000 a year to your medical care. It is now 2% of the entire GDP of the United States is going to diabetes alone. So it's just doubled. So we're looking at an avalanche of chronic diseases. from this. And here's one example. You know, 10 years ago, you get off the plane and one person would be greeted with a wheelchair, and now there's a line of wheelchairs every time I get off the plane. And this is one of the leading cause of people needing prosthesis nowadays is amputations because of gangrene from diabetes. This is crazy. Sorry the young kids left, because when I was a young pediatrician, I never saw a child with type 2 diabetes. We called it adult onset diabetes. We now call it type 2. You walk into the children's diabetes clinic today, half the kids have type 2, quote unquote, adult onset diabetes. And I swear they have diseases of 50, 60, 70-year-olds, you know, the heart failure, the fatty liver, the joint issues, et cetera. And think about the costs for that individual, costs for that family, and the cost for society having double diabetes in a blink of an eye, less than a generation. And there are fixes for this. I'll give you one more quick one. Not only is 1/8 of all of Americans have diabetes, but another 36% have pre-diabetes. If the doctor says to me, you have pre-diabetes, your hemoglobin A1C is too high, they're going to give me a bunch of advice. But number one is change your diet. No fats, very much less sugar. But number two is you got to exercise. You got to walk. You got to exercise. You got to walk. And this, you've all heard 10,000 steps a day. If you can do more, that's great. If you build a place where people can't walk, damn it, you're giving them diabetes. I'm probably overstating that somewhat, but you are preventing people from the most important health intervention they possibly could be doing once they've been given that diagnosis. Here's the classic study. This is a study done by NIH around 2002 or 3. They had fenformin, metformin, they had two other drugs, and they had one little arm that said, with 3,000 people, we'll just have you walk 10,000 steps a day, 4 or 5 days a week, and we'll see what happens after 6 months. After 6 months, which group had the fewest negative complications from their diabetes? The walkers, far and away. They had no negative effects from the walking. In fact, it was good for them. They lost 6% of their body mass, and nothing worked as well as walking. So in a way, creating places. So 100 years ago, as Kaiser said, we built places so people wouldn't get cholera and diarrhea and all these infectious diseases. Now we've got to build places that help people mitigate and control chronic diseases. And you get old enough, we're all going to get chronic diseases, but you'd like to delay as much of this as you possibly can in your life. Nothing works better than walking. And yet we do things, and this is a bit of a joke slide, but underneath, and I'll have a couple of joke slides in here, underneath the joke is the fact that sidewalks are second-class funded citizens in the sense that the city would think nothing of spending a lot of money fixing up the road, but they tell the homeowner, you're in charge of the sidewalk. So we've devolved the responsibility for sidewalks when, in fact, most of us need to be walking those 10,000 steps, so we should really put that right up front, not at the very back. Now, admittedly, Americans need to change our DNA, and this is to remind me that this poor dog is trying to do its duty to take the owner for a walk, and the owner is failing us. And by the way, dog owners walk more than non-dog owners. It's very good data. I'm not making that up. We build neighborhoods, and this is hugely important. This is a brand new neighborhood in Florida. And imagine, this is not too bright, but imagine you walked into the house at the end of the blue, you moved into the house at the end of the blue line, and you made friends with the family on the other side of the fence, and they said, geez, Memorial Day's coming up, let's have a cook-up, you bring your kids over, we'll have a lot of fun, and geez, that'd be nice, I'll make the potato salad, and I'll bring some ribs, and we'll have a lot of fun, and she's only 35 feet away, so, but it's a pretty high fence, and I don't want to throw the baby over the fence, so I think I'd better drive, but I don't know how to get there because I'm new here. So I go to Google, and I discover that I can drive for 17 minutes to go 7 miles to get the house 35 feet away. This is a true story, and of course, underneath the joke is the reality, and it's a deep reality. We think about people's needs last when we build, and what we need to think about first when we build, when we design, we create communities, is what people actually need to lead healthy, happy lives. So, how am I doing? Oh, it's 8 o'clock. 5, 10 more minutes? Okay. I had the world's most interesting, quasi-impossible job when I was at CDC. I had the childhood lead program, the cancer epidemiology, the birth defects epidemiology, chemical body burdens in people, including endocrine disruptors, destruction of the chemical weapons of the United States government, radiation hazards downwind from the nuclear tests, overseas stuff for Vice President Gore around radiation, Russia, and other things, and worried about climate change. And one day I was told to come to the director's office because they were doing this big paper on the big killers of the 21st century. And I'm driving to the director's office on Buford Highway in Atlanta, Georgia. And it's 6 lanes wide with a suicide lane in the middle. And it's 95 degrees, 95% humidity, and I'm rushing to get there because, of course, I'm always late. And I look over to the right side of the road, and here's this elderly woman walking along. She's bent over with osteoporosis, and she is carrying a plastic shopping bag in this heat along this rutted mud side of the road. And I want to stop and give her a ride. She looks like my mother, and I don't do it. Go to my meeting, and I'm thinking to myself, that poor woman collapses. The cause of death will be heat stroke, and it won't be bad urban planning, absence of trees, absence of public transit. And she's killed by a truck going by. The cause of death will be motor vehicle trauma, and it won't be absence of public transit, absence of sidewalks. So I literally went back, and you'll see one of the authors here is Howie Frumkin, and I called Howie, and I said, we've been spending our careers worried about environmental health, and we have not spent any time thinking about where people live and how they lead their lives and how they cope with their young children and their elderly isolated parents and 2 career jobs, and we need to really think a lot more about urban planning in the 21st century. And he said, okay, and we actually ended up writing a book and doing a bunch of things about this. But that was the beginning of the aha moment. I wrote this paper for Sprawl Watch saying how we're building America is killing people. And so the National Association of Home Builders was thrilled. They wrote to the head of CEC and said, fire that fool Jackson. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And the boss calls me in and he says, Dick, you're saying here that how we're making America is making people obese. And I said, well, Jeff, you know, it's just obvious. If you make places where nobody can walk, they're going to weigh about 7 pounds heavier, and that's the difference between sprawl areas and walking areas, about 7 pounds. If you tell people to go eat healthy food and there's no place to eat healthy food, you're not doing them a favor. He said, Dick, you don't have any data. I said, well, nobody's done any research, but it's just obvious. Well, he goes, you have to be quiet. He didn't fire me, but he did say you have to have some more data before you say much more, so I went off to do that. Let's skip these. Over the next 10 years, the nice thing about being at CDC is I invited the person that was did all the research on CEPTED, Community Policing Through Environmental Design, and how crime goes down if you design the community well. I invited the Sullivans, and who did all the studies looking at Cabrini Green and the high-rise slums, and they had a great study on the presence of greenery and how crime goes down. The Cabrini Green was built in a way, they ran out of money about halfway through the landscaping, so one end of the high-rise projects were hardened. They were just concrete and dust and dirt. And the other end was pretty nice with trees and benches and all the rest. It seems obvious, but which end do you think crime was lower? Which end do you think the kids played more reasonably? Which end do you think there was less domestic abuse? And it was kind of common sense, but nobody had ever done the study. And there was just, you know, and then water pollution and how you build and impervious surfaces and air pollution and burning fuels and all the rest. We had NASA come in. We ended up writing our first book out of all of this. We began to argue that kids ought to walk and bike to school because, and there's data on this, kids that walk and bike to school learn better, behave better, socialize better than kids that don't. By the way, do kids learn better in a small school or a big school? Small. And yet we continually build bigger and bigger and bigger schools because we're trying to save money. And we build it on cheap land outside of town because that they can sell off the nice quality school downtown and, you know, build a much bigger school way outside of town. I'm going to skip these, and I apologize. The Academy of Pediatrics wrote a position statement saying kids need to grow up in neighborhoods. It was a prescription. Kids need to grow up in neighborhoods where they can walk, play, and socialize and have increasing autonomy. Richard Louv wrote a book called The Last Child in the Woods about the need for children to have more nature contact. This is the National Academy of Sciences. The Institute of Medicine did an evaluation. Remember, I just showed you the epidemic of obesity in the United States, and they were asked, how do we turn around the obesity epidemic? Look at recommendation number one. They had 30 recommendations. Number one was communities start building places where people can have more physical activity. Now, why would they say that ahead of even farmers markets? I'll tell you, because high levels of physical activity, walking and exercising, can overcome the effects of being overweight. But it's better to not be overweight, but if I am overweight, at least keeping my physical activity and my exercise up is the best preventive I can possibly be doing. That's why they said, please, developers, build this way. The Surgeon General just came out with this report about 2 years ago saying, 30 years ago, he said, stop smoking, it causes cancer. I guess it's 50 years ago now. But here's the report saying, stop sitting on your behind and start walking. And this is the prescription from the Surgeon General's. I think this study is so cool. This is Charlotte, North Carolina. They have banks there. They have, Wells Fargo and Bank of America's headquartered there. And they put in a light rail to get people downtown to reduce the crowding getting downtown. And they happened to be doing a health study years before, and they had a snapshot of the people's, about 1,000 people's health, 2,000 people before. And they went back after the light rail had been put in place, and randomly about half the people started taking light rail, and half of them, because they wanted to save money, read a book, not be stressed. The other half kept driving. What do you think happened after a couple years of light rail? The light rail users were 80% had lost 6.5 pounds compared to the non-users. They weren't doing this to lose weight. They weren't doing it as a physical activity thing. They were doing it to make their life quality better. This is the whole business about life quality getting better at the same time your health can get better. So light rail, we don't think of it as a health intervention, but it is a way to do it. Ciclovia, and I'm almost done. I don't know if you saw the headline after the first Ciclovia. I think it was on Wilshire or Venice Boulevard. But I remember people being interviewed, and the question was, how'd you like it? And they said, well, geez, I didn't know I could get downtown faster on a bike than I could in a car. And I didn't know the people were so nice, and I didn't know the buildings were so interesting. And people were really impressed because, and this is why festivals are so important, because they're kind of a pop-up event that makes people, remember, everything started in our minds, it changes people's minds about things. This is the Chinoge Freeway going through downtown Seoul, South Korea. They ripped it out, cost them $900 million to rip it out and reveal the creek or stream underneath the freeway. And you don't need, a doctor doesn't need to wag his finger at people and say you need to walk. If you create places that are irresistible, people do it. And I saw in your profile that people wanted more places to walk. They wanted more downtown retail. Actually, I thought you're all urban planning experts because it was the most sensible set of assessments I had seen in a long time. But I was thinking a lot about this, and I think one of the biggest successes has been when people take a deficit and turn it into an asset. And so I'll give you two examples of a deficit. Lower West Side of Manhattan had a railroad track that was 3 stories above the meatpacking district that was abandoned and rusty for the last 50 years. And that, of course, was turned into the High Line. The High Line led to the whole revision and rebuilding of that part of New York, and yeah, it became gentrified and people want to live there, but it's a lot safer now and you can buy good food and it's quite beautiful. And when I took my 2-year-old grandson walking along there, it was the nicest time I had the whole time I was in Manhattan, because the rest of the time I was hanging onto his hand for dear life, and at least on the High Line he could wander around, I could watch him more closely. But the High Line is, it was a deficit that became an asset, is now the 10th, I'm not making this up, the 10th most visited tourist destination in the whole world, which is pretty amazing. I want to just stay with this, because Town and Country had another, the best places to live, and I love this one. The best places to live was related to the prevalence of high-quality, locally-owned restaurants. And the more franchise stuff you had, the less they ranked that as a desirable place. So when you, as members of this community, did this assessment, and you said, I want locally-owned stuff. And by the way, locally-owned is a plus, plus, plus. Because the owner is local, he or she wants the front of that place looking presentable and having people come in. But hopefully they'll live in the neighborhood, and they want their neighborhood maintained as well. So the community is benefiting twice or maybe even three times by having a citizen retailer entrepreneur rather than somebody in New York or Hong Kong, Singapore, making all the money at the same time. So local business is a good thing. I meant to bring you a couple of these toolkits, but they're free online. This is the Urban Land Institute thinking about. I worked a lot with them. A lot of us worked with them on a Healthy Places toolkit. This is when we rolled it out for all of global Urban Land Institute, Europe and China and Tokyo and the rest, to think about how do you build healthy places. And I didn't mean to skip this. Sorry. Oh, remember I almost got fired? This was the American Public Health Association presentations in 2002 and 3 where land use was discussed. None. 102 by 2011, 182 on built environment. Here's last year. 1,000 presentations. Where I'm going with this is young people really get this. They want to be in places that are attractive and lively and they can walk. You know, when I was young in New Jersey, last place anybody ever wanted to go to was Brooklyn. And now Brooklyn is like the hot thing. And Oakland keeps saying we're the West Coast Brooklyn because they want to be as booming. But the young people want to live in lively places. And they saw the rat race lives that a lot of their parents were leading, and they don't want to duplicate it. Skip this, sorry. This is a bit technical, but it is the Journal of the American Medical Association. This was done in the Canadians can do very good studies because they have all everybody's medical records and they have maps of the whole geography. Here's the walkability map for the Toronto region. The details aren't needed. But the most walkable area, which do you think, it's obesity and diabetes prevalence over the last 10 years. Which do you think was the most walkable area? Lower is better. It's the bottom one. So the most walkable areas had the least obesity and diabetes. But I really like this one because we're trying to turn around these epidemics. And again, the most walkable areas saw a decline in the rates of these diseases. It's not perfect, but you know, we turn the dials to make us all less active and gain weight. We need to turn the dials to make us all more active and lose some weight. And by the way, we might smile and be less depressed when that happens. So I apologize. I have jammed a whole year's course into 1 hour, but free for questions. And thank you very much. Thank you so much. I don't mean to be so depressing. In my video series, I feature Elgin, Illinois, and it's quite moving when you see the watchtower, the clock tower in Elgin being dynamited, and it's where the Elgin watches were made. All of our military in World War II wore Elgin watches. This one town, they employed 5,000 people, and Timex came along, and Elgin went dust, and the tower falls down, and the Fox River, where it was built in Illinois, becomes depressed, and it's a Superfund site all the way along. And the supervisor came in, and the councilman came in and said, we're going to become a sustainable city. And they actually started with sustainability. And they used Superfund money to turn that whole stretch along the river, the junkyards and the paint factories, and into a walking trail, running trail, that went maybe a couple miles in each direction. And then they said, well, you know, this is pretty cool. So they began to do the walking trail, biking trail across the town, and that is now the center of the all Illinois bike route. So the two bike routes, north, south, and east, west, go through that. They put a town square with a band shell. It is so beautiful that when young couples get married now in Elgin, Illinois, they want to have their pictures taken in the band shell with the river and the trees and everything behind it. You can probably fish out of that river. They're in the process of converting their schools and running bike routes to every single one of their schools, because that's really an important thing as well, so the kids can walk and bike to school. And the but it really was the sustainability thing that opened the door first, you know, less carbon footprint. And it was funding came from that. And then over time, the health advocates, and particularly the health directors, and I've seen this in Las Cruces and other places, is the doctors will step up and actually go to a planning commission meeting, and I'll give them my slides, or they'll use slides like this, and they'll say, look, you know, I'm the mayor's cardiologist. They don't say I'm the mayor's cardiologist, but they say things like that. I take care of city leaders that have heart disease, and I always give them the same advice. Walk more, eat more sensibly, watch your diet, and if you make places that make people have to stay in the car all the time, I'm not helping them. And it doesn't take a lot. They don't have to be there more than 10, 15 minutes, but it does help that they appear. So the other quick one was we did a lot of survey. Anybody been to Charleston, South Carolina? It's a great city. And that mayor was there, Joe Riley was there 30-something years. And that they wanted to turn it into typical, lots of high rises, very expensive high rises near the bay and Fort Sumter in the distance. And he said, no, I'm going to retain the original character of the city. Character really is important. I'm going to have green esplanades along the thing. He brought in two culinary schools, which was brilliant. And probably at the time people thought that was nuts, but is now a food destination. And a lot of older people actually, a lot of us, I can't run anymore, but I can bike. And I like having bike destinations. And I like eating, it probably shows. But I don't want to eat junky food. So that really has made it a destination. The other thing he did, and this is pretty wild, is they were putting a river a bridge over the Cooper River, a big bridge. He insisted it be beautiful, number one. But number two, it have a bike route all the way along it so people could see the city as they came over the bridge. It is now the fifth most visited tourist destination in the city of Charleston, which has a huge amount of people. Because you get there and you eat all that stuff, you got to go for a bike ride, right? So there are success stories. And by the way, housing values go up, money goes up. Every bike route that I've ever, I'm not a world's expert on this, Kaiser would know more about it, but I agitated for one in Atlanta called the Silver Comet that went from Atlanta, the rail line into Atlanta to Alabama, Birmingham. And the neighbors said, we don't want that bike line. It brings in the wrong element, which in the South is code for race. And they said, and people will steal our big screen TVs on their bikes. And so eventually it was built. Now if you go to and look at Zillow or something, and you look at the price of houses, or any of the ads for houses along the bike route, the first thing it says is, on the bike route, because it's become, and actually has added value to these homes rather than detracted it. You know what the big problem right now with bike routes, by the way, is? I'm not making this up. Crowding. Because there are so many people, and this has happened in Atlanta with the Beltline as well, it's a victim of its own success, and so many people want to be on it. But poor Atlanta was going in all directions, and it needed the cincture. It needed to be pulled in, and the Beltline, the 37-mile bike route around downtown Atlanta, has really gave the city an identity that it never had when it was a giant expanding blob. Sounds like a movie, doesn't it?
Can I say that it also had the first preservation ordinance in the United States, Charleston? And I think that that's, continuing on with that, and that's something we need to continue on with here because we have an element, preservation element, and we're kind of worried about not including that.
You've triggered two quick thoughts. Joe Riley was the longest-serving mayor in American, at least modern history. Let me just say it outright. Mayors are really important. Local elected officials have a huge influence on the quality of people's lives, much more than what goes on in Washington, D.C. or anything else. So run for office, and thank you if you're in an office, because you really have a lot of impact on that. Two, there is a ridiculous law in many places in the United States around schools. And if the school, every building gets worn out. If the rehab of a school costs more, and I'll give a rough number, half the price of a new school, the law says you have to build a brand new school. You have to tear down the old one or move out of the old one and build a brand new one. You can figure out where that law came from. There were obviously developers and land users and construction people that wanted this. But in truth, this American belief that we should throw away everything old is bad for sustainability, but it's actually bad because those that forget history are doomed to repeat it. And we have really got to cherish the history of this country, and particularly at a time that I think our identity is so fragile and endangered. Thank you for that comment.
What you said about young people wanting things to change and really getting it, and I take care of some young families in my practice. You know, some of them are from Silver Lake, and they're really into healthy eating and things like that. And one of them said to me, you know, we want our village back. People want their village back. And so, you know, they come into the farmers market in South Pasadena, and I think that's kind of where, you know, people want their village back.
I never thought of this. I'm going to use this. It takes a village. No, but I mean, it does. It, you know, you go to Italy, you go to Mexico, and it's 7 o'clock at night. You can see the smoke, and the lights are out, and teenage boys are walking in this direction. The teenage girls are walking in this direction. It's courting behavior. You know, you should run up and say, hey, you can meet somebody nice on OkCupid. But it's courting behavior is important, and we need to create safe ways that people can go about their life needs. And the old folks, of course, are watching, and the kids are all running around, sort of observing what's going on. It's totally, I love this word, organic, in the best sense of that word. It's organic means that the thing belongs there. It's not imposed from somewhere else, in my mind. Let me stop there and be available individually. And oh, Kaiser, do you want to sign off?
Dr. Jackson, thank you for a very inspiring talk. I have a little bit of homework because I'm pretty sure I'm going to see all of you next week. And we're going to get to know each other very well for the working through the entire week. As you walk down Mission and Fair Oaks, I want you to make some mental observations about some of the ideas about how we can make it more walkable. Physical activities that we can put. You asked about examples. I want to suggest to you that when we go around the country and we watch planning presentations or give presentations across the country, and we're talking about communities that are your size, 25,000 people or so, you are an example. What you've done with your TOD, the farmers market, the Mission Meridian Project, I mean, these are slides that are shown around the country as how to best design a place, how to make it more walkable. But we're also interested in keeping the good going. We're interested in a resilient community as we live in a very uncertain environment. So please think about some ideas and bring your ideas to the Charette. I want to quickly walk you through the program for the Charette. We all eat at lunchtime. Come eat lunch with us. We have noontime talks. So we'll give you lunch, but we'll also entertain your mind. And we'll start off Monday noon with a presentation on the South Pasadena economy. We have Amitabh Bar Thakur, who will be making a presentation on the market analysis that his firm has been doing. So we'll kick it off with Monday afternoon talk by Amitabh on the South Pasadena economy. He's a resident. He's local. On Tuesday, on Monday evening, we have opening night presentation. So we'll be sharing with you Monday evening at 6:30 p.m. All of the discovery work that you've done, including the survey results, which are online, so you can take a look at those results. But we'll present snapshots of synoptic analysis of some of the work that we've been doing in terms of discovery. And the point of that is, this is how we all understood our community to be. What are we missing? Do we overlook some areas to come to common ground as we start the week? So that's going to happen Monday evening. On Tuesday, the architect of the project, Mission Meridian, and one of the projects that Dr. Jackson skimmed over in Lancaster, Stefanos Polizoides, will be talking about vibrant downtowns. Stefanos is a well-known entity in the in Southern California as well as a nation, and he's been involved with various downtowns. He's part of our charrette team. His office will be leading the charrette. He'll give a talk on elements of vibrant downtown at noon on Tuesday. On Wednesday, we'll have Steve Bolin and Lauren Matten present their thoughts, ideas on parking and mobility concepts about how we move around the city, not just cars, but the various mobility options that we have. On Thursday, we'll have a joint presentation by Vinayak Bonney. Vinayak is with Stefanos's office, Molin Polozoid. He'll talk about elements of a great neighborhood, and then I'll talk about how we take all of this information and prepare a code. So we're not just talking about vision, but we're also talking about implementation. How do you implement that vision? What are the codes that we will need? So we'll talk about that on Thursday afternoon. And then on evening, on all of these days, Tuesday and Wednesday evening, we'll have what we are calling crit sessions, or critique sessions, where we'll take some of the feedback that you give us on each evening, we'll go back to the drawing boards, we'll make some changes, and we'll present them the next evening. We'll take some more feedback, we'll work on the drawings. Our goal is we'll work through the 5 days in this community. You're in the school, the South Pasadena School District boardroom, and our goal is to, at the end of 5 days, have a community-driven vision for the downtown area and the guiding principles for the city as a whole, for the general plan area. So on Friday evening at 6:30, we'll host an open house. We'll just have all of the drawings, all of the display work, all of the work that we've done thus far, and the work that we'll do next week displayed. And we'll allow you to just wander in the room, ask questions, we'll be there. And then at the end of the evening, we'll make a brief presentation and talk about next steps. So that's the plan for next week. Any questions on the shred? I have one request. Please bring your neighbors and friends, because this shred process works if we have everyone at the table. And it only works if we have a good broad representation. So please help us. Thank you and good night.